Welcome to the Underground, the Steel City Underground, the black and gold standard for Pittsburgh Steelers coverage. Now, here are your hosts, Brian E. Roach and Christina Rivers.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to another edition of the Steel City Underground podcast. I am Brian Roach, your host for tonight. The host who still, to this day, doesn't like toast, refuses to like toast. I'm not changing. It doesn't matter what anybody tells me. But I'm not flying solo, and I'm not flying with my normal compatriot, Joe Kuzma. Instead, it is the wondrous, knowledgeable, fantabulous, pick-your-own-adjectives to describe her. Christina Rivers is going to join us again on the podcast. Tina, welcome aboard.
Thanks for having me on, Brian. And I just wanted to tell you, my initial thought was I wanted to talk about Tanya Harding on Dancing with the Stars, but I decided football was a lot more important and way more exciting.
Wow, I'm really glad you've made that decision. As crushed as I am not to be able to do a Dancing with the Stars podcast, as disappointed as our listeners will be, I think it's the right move.
Yeah, I don't like to disappoint the listeners, especially now that you're famous. You and Joe are like the toast brothers. So, you know, now that I'm the girl that likes bagels, we can't really go to figure skating and Dancing with the Stars unless it's a Steelers player that's going to be on there, and it's not. So who cares about Tanya Harding? Let's talk football.
Excellent. So, you know, as I'm sure you're aware, the last couple episodes, Joe and I have been focusing on one Le'Veon Bell. And I think if we want to look back, it's the first episode, which was two podcasts ago. Let's call that episode one. What does Le'Veon want? And we tried to empathize with him. We tried to see the world through Le'Veon Bell colored glasses. And then we moved on to episode two, The Draft Strikes Back. And I know I'm mixing my trilogies up and whatnot, but I don't care. And in that, we talked about, you know, potential draft picks that could conceivably be beneficial for the Steelers to take in the event that Le'Veon Bell doesn't get a long-term deal done and ends up being done after this season. Now, we had some commentary on those podcasts, and people were one of the big conversation points is, should the Steelers trade Le'Veon Bell? And so let's call this third episode, I don't know, the rise of the trade or something like that. I can't think of something, but this is the closing chapter of our trilogy. Yes.
Yeah. Kind of like revenge of the franchise tag.
Oh, there you go. It's beautiful. That's the most awesome. Revenge of the franchise tag. And that's going to, this will be our, go. Yeah, there you go. This will be our closing chapter to the Le'Veon Bell trilogy for us. So, you know, the premise here, of course, is that the Steelers would love to be able to maybe move up in the draft, maybe get other picks, maybe do something else. Since the likelihood of a Bell deal actually occurring seems to be very small at this point. You know, a lot of fans have tossed around the idea of, can we trade him? And I know there was an article that was posted not too long ago out there about talking about how, oh no, it wasn't an article. It was Nate Burleson on Good Morning Football who said Le'Veon Bell is untradeable, right? He can't be traded. He's the one untradeable person on the Steelers. I don't agree with that, but there are some reasons to think that this may be more difficult than not. Right, Tina?
Yes, and it's interesting because his counterpart at NFL.com, Adam Rank, this was what he said when he was talking about Bell versus, like, Brown, because he was talking about the untradeable, in quotes, is usually the face of a franchise. And Adam Rank said, Brown is the best receiver of the last 20 years. I truly believe it would be far easier to replace Le'Veon Bell than Brown. So even NFL analysts are going back and forth. You know, Nate Burleson doesn't even agree with Adam Rank. And that brings up all the fans that have talked on social media about Is he tradable? Is he untradable? What's the deal with the franchise tag? And I think it's helpful for people to understand exactly what the franchise tag entails and the process that it would have to go through for the Steelers to trade Bell.
Yeah. What? So the franchise tag itself right now, of course, he hasn't signed it. So technically, Bell is not under contract to the Steelers. He's not currently a Steelers employee. And as a result of that, at the moment, do they have any ability to trade Le'Veon Bell?
Well, under the exclusive franchise tag, he was given a one-year tender offer for an amount no less than the average of the top five salaries at that player's position for the current year, or 120% of his previous salary, whichever is greater. And because it's an exclusive tag, he can't negotiate with another team. And it's interesting because usually when teams give someone an exclusive tag, that's a player that's like the cream of their crop. They're players that they would gladly give up two first-round picks to sign. So that kind of gives it a little bit more weight as to what this exclusive tag that's been placed on Bell means. It shows that the Steelers value him. It shows that they respect his ability, what he brings to the offense. So some of the comments that have been made in kind of a passive-aggressive way by Bell on social media don't really match up with being given the exclusive tag. If they'd given him the transition tag, which is a totally different set of rules and pay, then maybe I could see him getting a little bit more bent out of shape. But they're saying that they want him, they value him. And he can sign the tender at any point, but he hasn't, you're right. And until it's signed, the Steelers can rescind that tag. Not resend, but rescind the tag. So if he doesn't sign, it's no contract, no fines for missing the offseason. But he only has until 4 p.m. Eastern time on July 16th to negotiate a multi-year contract with the team. And after that, he'll only be able to sign a one-year contract for the 2018 season. So if he doesn't sign, no contract, no fines for missing the offseason, which is similar to what he did last year. And the result of that was he didn't break out really until October.
Right. So based on his current situation, right, if he were to choose never to sign the tag, he can't play anywhere else, but he won't play is essentially what would happen. He would not play this year. And what would happen to him in 2019? Would he immediately become an unrestricted free agent?
Well, if the Steelers were to rescind the tag, here's the perfect example. In 2016, the Carolina Panthers pulled what at the time was an unprecedented pre-draft shocker, and they rescinded a non-exclusive franchise tag on cornerback Josh Norman. As soon as they rescinded the tag, it immediately made him an unrestricted free agent. Under the tag, Norman was in line to make close to $14 million. It was $13.952 million. But then Darrell Revis got a five-year $70.1 million deal, and then he wanted to test the waters. And he felt that if Patrick Peterson was going to get a $70 million contract with $48 million guaranteed, and Richard Sherman was going to get a $56 million extension with a $40 million guaranteed, he felt he should be able to get the same numbers. Now, General Manager Dave Gettleman, I believe he's with the Giants now, he was with the Panthers at the time, said that after a number of conversation with Josh's agent, they'd realized that a long-term deal was not attainable.
Right.
After they rescinded that franchise tag, 2 days later, Josh Norman signed a five-year $75 million deal with the Redskins and became the highest paid cornerback in the league at that time. So there is a precedent. And yes, it would make Bell an unrestricted free agent. But there's an interesting point to consider. Shut down corners in the NFL are much harder to find than running backs.
Absolutely true.
So whether or not, okay, it comes down to then whether or not Bell has a legitimate, like you said, you and Joe talked about. Does he have a legitimate reason to not want their franchise tag? Most players don't like the franchise tag. They'd rather have some kind of a deal, mostly a guaranteed money deal. But right now, the fair contract value for Bell would be about $12 to $13 million. Some teams may pay $15 million. And if you look at Devonta Freeman and LeSean McCoy, they make $16.2 million combined, which means that Bell asking, and it's, I don't know, it's reportedly that he wants a $17 million and that he doesn't want to leave that number. The problem is that the Steelers hold all the leverage here. So could they trade him? Technically, they could rescind his franchise tag. They could rescind his offer. Then he would be a free agent. He could become an agent. But Ron Cook, he's a Steelers writer. A lot of people know. He just recently wrote that he felt that the Steelers wouldn't rescind the tag because they've never done that. They've always honored their commitments. So really, with that leverage and not having a history of rescinding tags, I don't think that there is a possibility, at least, I mean, it's got to be very minimal, that the Steelers are even considering a trade.
Right, and here, there's something breaking right now, which is we've gotten an inside look into the Le'Veon Bell Steelers negotiations, okay? So this will be pretty interesting. This is what's going on as Bell and the Steelers are talking. And I think it'll be the Steelers are going to come to the plate first and explain what they're offering, and then Bell will respond. So let's listen in.
O Knights of Nick, we have brought you your shrubbery. May we go now?
It is a good shrubbery. I like the laurels particularly. But there is one small problem.
What is that?
We are now no longer the knights who say neep, neep. We are now the knights who say ecky, 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 fatang, zoom, boing, boom. Therefore, we must give you a test.
What is this test, knights who till recently said nee?
Firstly, you must find another shrubbery!
Another shrubbery! I feel like, okay, you know, that obviously wasn't really the contract negotiations, but I feel like that's kind of the way it's gone. Okay? Because, yeah. You know, it's last year, his tag was 12 point something, right? And the Steelers made him an offer, you know, reportedly that was a very fair offer. May not have averaged out to 12 million a year at that time, but it was reportedly a fair offer. And he said, no, that's not good enough. Now, I don't know if he wanted 17 million last year, but I feel like every time his claim is, I want to be valued. I want to be paid my worth. I want to be shown, I want to reset the running back market. The deal he was offered last year did all of those things. And so when they came to the table, and Joe's thrown this meme out there where, you know, they offer him a plate and he just tosses it down the hall. It feels like this.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, he's here's your offer, and he goes, well, that was a good offer. It's a nice offer, but things have changed, and now we need another shrubbery. So, I don't know what he expects to happen, but it just feels that way. It feels like, at times, there is absolutely no way the Steelers are going to get this deal done because the target that Bell seems to set for them keeps moving. And whether that's accurate or not, maybe he wanted $17 million last year and he was living in a fantasy land and he's just stayed in that fantasy land about $17 million. It's not going to happen. And unless he, you know, I don't know the legalities of this, and maybe you do, but as far as the league is concerned, is it feasible that the Steelers could start talking to other teams and saying, look, if you would like to chuckle, chuckle, wink, wink, nudge, nudge, pay $17 million a year for Le'Veon Bell, we'll trade you to him, or we'll trade him to you if for something. I don't expect that there's a team out there willing to do that, but who knows? Maybe there is. And if that's the case, could they do that? Could they be, even though he's not technically under contract to them, could they negotiate with other teams right now?
from my understanding, they can't negotiate and he can't negotiate. So I'm not sure how that would work. And I'm just going to be honest about that. I'd have to look into that a little bit more. As far as now, if he became an unrestricted free agent, I think that he can talk and they can talk. But I don't know if they can trade him, because if he's an unrestricted free agent, then they don't have a restriction on him. So yeah. that's something I'd have to look into a little bit more.
Yeah, my understanding is that nobody can actually negotiate at this point. The only options for Bell are to sign the tag and play for the Steelers. Now, if he were to sign the tag, if he doesn't get a deal done and he was to sign the tag, I do believe the Steelers could trade him at that point, and the team that takes him would simply have to pay the tag value. And then they could go through this drama next year with him.
Yeah.
But,
you know, it was interesting because on the Steelers Live today, they interviewed Coach Tomlin specifically about Bell. And one of the things that he kept saying is there are consequences. And he mentioned that it's not just consequences for not showing up, because, I mean, monetarily, he doesn't get fined, so it's not a monetary consequence. But Tomlin pointed out that he's not showing up. He's not showing veteran leadership to the younger guys. He's not there improving his game. He's not there with his teammates, improving the cohesion that they have on the offense. So I thought that was really interesting that they just happened to talk to Coach Tomlin about that today.
Yeah.
And that he kept emphasizing consequences. So I don't know if that brings if that's kind of like another little hint, you know, okay, Le'Veon, you know, you've been passive aggressive and threatening to retire. Well, we have, you know, as a team, the Steelers, we have the leverage. So here are the consequences. So it's kind of almost like a social media battle. It's kind of a behind the scenes battle. And I don't know. I really don't believe that they will rescind the tag. They don't really need to rescind the tag. Now, if he decides to go just pull a James Harrison, for example, and not show up at meetings or sleep through meetings, then I think their hand is going to be forced a little bit as to what they'll do.
Yeah, I mean, I think at this point, you know, I think they're probably, I mean, Colbert was very upfront saying we have other things to concern ourselves with at this point, and we will deal with Le'Veon after the draft. Makes sense, complete sense. And we're going to talk about some of those things that they've been dealing with, because there's actual real Steelers news to talk about today that has happened this week. But, you know, I think...
Thank heavens, we can move on from the trilogy.
Yeah, it all will help us wind up the trilogy on a positive note, maybe. Who knows? But... I think the thing is that if they cannot work something out before the deadline, then Joe and I have both talked about this, and this is definitely Bell's last year. But one of the narratives that keeps coming out is that there's a lot of fans who think the Steelers are talking bad and the media is talking bad about Bell. Look, reporting the facts, which are the facts, are, yes, he's been clean for a couple of years, but he does have on his record these drug issues that, you know, whether they were real issues or whether, you know, it's a missed test and because he just didn't figure out how to take his test, he failed the test. If he does it again, if he gets that same confusion, you know, wakes up late one day and goes, oh, I forgot I had a test today and doesn't go, well, then he's suspended for a year. So, you know, it's not just that these mistakes were made. That does count. And it isn't the Steelers putting it out there. Nobody's really trying to badmouth Le'Veon Bell and saying he's a bad guy because he smoked some pot with, blunt. He hit a blunt with blunt, in a car. But, you know, if I could hit a blunt with blunt, I would hit a blunt with blunt. But I can't hit a blunt with blunt because blunt don't know me and I don't know him. Plus, I'm old and I don't know how to buy that stuff. So... Be that
and
as
be
it may.
Ridiculous to do it in a vehicle.
Right. You're ridiculous to do it in a vehicle on your way to the airport to go to a game. And
well, yeah, exactly. Yeah.
But does that make Le'Veon Bell a bad person? No, absolutely not. I'm on the fence in saying I think pot should be legal in all states. And if it was legal in all states, then I don't think it becomes a banned substance in the NFL anymore. I don't really have an issue with pot. Okay. But it's still against the rules. And it's not about, you know, whether he's good or bad. It's about the fact that there is a risk with him that if he has any kind of an issue that doesn't mean a relapse. It just could be, oh, I had a forgetful day and I forgot to take my test. And because he missed his test, it counts as a failure and boom, he's suspended. So that is a risk that teams have to analyze. So the narrative that people are trying to bring up the past and say bad things about him, it's a legitimate problem that exists. And I don't think it means he's bad. I don't think it means he's a bad person. Do I expect this to happen? Absolutely not. But it's a risk. And it's part of why teams are not necessarily going to be willing to invest that kind of money in him. But secondarily, they're not going to do it because it simply doesn't fit. And here let's transition briefly into what has happened this week. Specifically, you know, Joe and I talked about John Bostic and the Morgan Burnett signings. But on top of that, you've got a guy, Chris Boswell, who's been an excellent kicker, Pro Bowl kicker last year, is Mr. Clutch, the man. He's money. He's the Wizard of Boz. He's money. He signed a $2.9 million tender that he had. So he's under contract. He's pulled in. The Steelers added more depth by signing the I can't say his last name. I'm terrible with names. But the safety from the Giants, who's a special teams ace, calls himself the Missile. They signed him.
Yeah, Matt Verhey.
Yeah. And then they signed Stephen Ridley. They signed Justin Hunter to a one-year contract, all of which, you know, helps the team. And none of those are huge moves. None of those are going to be blockbuster kind of deals, but they're moves that help stabilize the team, that help make the team better, that provide security, and those kind of moves need to happen to insulate the team from potential issues as time goes on. And plus, I mean, you got to have people to play special teams. You can't not play special teams, right? So this guy's a special teams ace, essentially replacing Robert Golden.
And I think, you know, speaking on that, Murray, you know, a lot of people, especially Giants fans, were excited that the Giants moved on from him. And what's interesting is here we got Burhey, and then William Gay, he just signed with the Giants. So it was kind of a trade, but not a trade because they're free agents and that doesn't count. So, but one thing that I know about Burhey that a lot of people have pointed out as far as analysts and draft scouts and things before he entered the league was he is a very intelligent, disruptive player. And with the Giants, he was pretty much the quarterback of their punt team. And if you're not aware, and most fans may not be aware, it's kind of the same equation as Ryan Shazier having been the quarterback of the defense. Burhey was the communicator. He would get everybody lined up. He would make sure that they knew which play they were running. And so having a guy at safety who is able to communicate on that level, that doesn't mean that they signed him because they think that he's going to be a day one starter. But the Steelers are doing something really smart. They're building depth at the bottom of their depth chart. They're not signing people who are going to be inserted into the quote-unquote starter position. Now, with Rob Golden going to the Kansas City Chiefs and Mike Mitchell still unsigned, Burhey is actually a really good move for them because he's at 26 years old. This is his fifth year in the league. Now, he missed all of 2015. A lot of Giants fans were going crazy about that because it was his second season. And he had a calf injury that forced a subsequent surgery to remove a blood clot. Now, the blood clot wasn't injury related, so we can't really lump it. Oh, he's injury prone. No, he had unfortunate, you know, secondary issue to a calf injury that was more than just a tear of a calf muscle. And I'm excited to see him play because I think that he gives Danny Smith something else on the special teams unit to get a spark going. Because there were times last season that the special teams didn't look very special.
True. Well, I mean, they had their moments last year. I will say it was a year where I was much less likely to be putting the special teams in the ugly column on the good, bad, and ugly on after the game. You know, but nonetheless, they were – you can always improve, right? You can always improve. And they still had their coverage issues. But they were a little more exciting last year. I got to give them that.
Well, I mean, there's a difference between, you know, letting somebody just break away. They weren't letting people just break out a big long return on them every weekend. They were doing their jobs. It's just the possibility of a little bit more spark, a little bit more intensity. You know, having Mitchell was kind of gave them that. Now that he's not with them, now they've got somebody back there with veteran experience. Yes, he's still young. He's got a lot. Who knows? At 5'11", 195 pounds, and former San Diego State player, I mean, he still has potential. And I think it's good for them to have leadership depth, you know, veteran depth, somebody who's experienced, who's played.
Absolutely.
And some of these other signings, you mentioned Justin Hunter. He wasn't a huge contributor in 2017. But with Eli Rogers, a huge question mark, it makes sense to have Hunter. Right now, he'd probably be wide receiver number 4. And then who knows what they're going to do in the draft. But why not keep him? I mean, we get into the business aspect of it. They can keep him for cheaper than they can go out and sign a big-name free agent that they sit on the depth chart at number 4. Who, you know, nobody wants to get put at number 4 if they're making top money.
Absolutely. And I mean, who are they going to replace at wide receiver? Not Antonio Brown, not Juju, not Martavis Bryant next year. You know, so the Hunter signing, look, as you said, the thing that you said that I actually like the most and that I'm most excited about the free agent signings they've done is they're all good communicators. They're all guys who have called plays on the field, who know how to talk, because the defense last year when Shazier went down, the biggest issue for the entire rest of the season constantly appeared to be lack of communication, either with getting the right plays called, getting guys in the right position, passing off from one guy to the next guy, passing receivers appropriately. However you want to look at it, it all felt like they simply failed to communicate. And I could play that, you know, cool hand Luke clip and, you know, what we got here's failure to communicate. And that was definitely what the Steelers had on the defense for most of the rest of the season. So I'm thrilled that the guys that they're bringing in are, you know, veteran communicators, so that maybe they saw that too and they went, man, we got to address that.
Well, and I think that's, you know, that's a really good point, because the Steelers, people witnessed it. They were so bipolar as far as their communication in the first, I don't know, all through September, they had issues with communication on offense. And it seemed like, okay, the defense is kind of keeps them in there. When there's miscommunications, the defense gets back on the field. That's all going good. And then all of a sudden it flipped. And you saw, and it wasn't just with Shazier's injury. I mean, a lot of people say, well, you know, once Shazier went down, it all kind of fell apart. It wasn't just one man that led to the confusion and what looked to be a lack of communication. Those guys have been practicing all year with each other. Surely they knew, you know, whether you're going to run a route or who you're going to cover. But there was times that they just plain looked like they weren't sure. They'd throw their hands up at each other, see them, it looked like they're out doing sign language, because you could tell that they were confused. And that's something that they need, is they need these guys. And it's good because Justin Hunter and Stephen Ridley, they were with the team last year. Maybe they weren't huge contributors, but they're part of the system. They already know the system. So being able to bring them back with the team just improves that level of communication and trust that guys have, because they build a rapport with their teammates. Whereas you bring somebody else in, that person doesn't have an immediate rapport. And, you know, one thing I like about the fact that they brought Ridley back was that he's not the multi-threat that Bell is in the passing game, but he adds that nice veteran depth and that ability to communicate. And he's more of a downhill bruising back. And I don't like to bring this up because D'Angelo Williams will probably tweet me about it, but Stephen Ridley really is kind of in a D'Angelo Williams type of a situation. If Bell does what he did last year, the Steelers' option would be to play James Conner, who's still untested, Fitzgerald Toussaint, and bring in Roosevelt Nix if they hadn't signed Stephen Ridley back with the team. So that's what it would have looked like if last year, with holding out of camp and everything we mentioned it before, he didn't really start showing up on the field until October. So it's the whole thing has been very smart how they've handled this.
Right. And I think the key to tie this all together, to bring our trilogy to a final conclusion, our Le'Veon trilogy, is these moves that they've made. They're not huge moves, they're not big news, but they're important moves. If they had gone ahead and done what some people have said, just pay him, just pay Le'Veon Bell, pay him the money. I can't do the Jerry Maguire voice for, what's his face? Show me the money. I can't do it. But, you know, Joe knows I'm terrible at impressions. Anyway.
It was a nice try, though. Yeah.
If they had shown him the money, they don't make any of these other signings because they ain't got no more room under the cap. You know, they got to figure out who to cut so they can sign the guys they're going to draft and, you know, get them in under the contract. They would be in such a bad position financially, which is one of the reasons the Steelers are not going to do that. They know better. And that's why it's not so simple. It simply isn't so simple to say, just pay the man, because you can't just pay the man. You know, you have to pay him and other guys, you know, and when it comes down to it, Joe posted this question to some guys in the past podcast as questions, and they agreed, and it goes this way: would you rather pay Le'Veon Bell $17 million a year and have him for the next 3-4 years, knowing that the mileage is going to wear on him, and maybe by year two he's not Le'Veon Bell the way we're used to it being Le'Veon Bell, and by year three he's really not? Or do you want to be able to, if Ryan Shazier is able to come back and play, re-sign Ryan Shazier and keep guys like Mike Hilton and Juju Smith-Schuster and Sean Davis and, you know, these kind of guys who are young upcomers and are going to need contracts? Like Juju is a second-round pick. So in 4 years, his contract's going to be up. You know, we don't get that fifth-year option with him because he's not a first-rounder. So do you want to be able to keep the core players that you've been drafting, or do you want Le'Veon Bell until he, you know, his wheels fall off? That's the way that the team has to make these decisions. And I really want to emphasize this. I don't think nobody in, at least at SCU, is really calling Le'Veon greedy. But you know,
I don't think anyone is saying that at all. I mean, they all pretty much have agreed that, you know, business being business, players want their money. So it's not anybody at SCU saying, hey, you know, we're throwing shade at Le'Veon Bell.
Right.
It's not even about that.
No, we absolutely respect and understand his desire to try and get as much as he can get. And he should. I think that the issue comes in when you start to say, I want as much as I can get, and if I'm not going to get it, then I'm going to go in my corner and pout. and instead of coming to the table and saying, look, that is an offer. It may not be what I wanted, but man, that's $5 million more than any other running back's making in the league. That's an offer that makes me understand that you do value me. Yes, it's not what I wanted, but you know what? I can live with that. Because that's part of the issue and part of the hostility that comes out of fans is, you know, Pittsburgh is a blue collar town. You got blue collar fans. You got guys who are making, you know, $50,000-$60,000 a year and living off of that or less. And to have a guy, you know, come out and say it's hard to be a hero when everybody's painting you as a villain because he is upset that he's getting an offer of $13.1 million a year, that is, you know, that doesn't resonate. It just doesn't resonate.
No, and those are blue-collar type people that have, you know, saved up their money to go shell out $100+ on Bell's jersey. And I'm not saying that to make it sound like, I know that probably sounds really bad, but it's very realistic. A lot of those people that are feeling dissatisfaction in how he's acting is because, you know, they want to wear his number and they want to wear his name on their back when they go see him play. And they don't understand, you know, hey, if I got $1 million and won it in the lottery, I'd be set for life. But yet, you know, he's quibbling over a couple $1 million. Well, in the bigger picture of professional sports, you know, the difference between $5 million and $1 million is a lot, but and not really comparable to some, you know, non-professional sports or business. But I understand fans' dissatisfaction. I understand Bill's dissatisfaction. I also understand the Pittsburgh Steelers franchise's dissatisfaction and the frustration of trying to negotiate these things because, like you said, now with the people that they have signed, if they had given Bill the money, that six people, okay, including Bobby, that they wouldn't have been able to bring onto the roster. Unless Le'Veon Bell is going to play six different positions, they wouldn't have been able to give him that money and fill a roster. And this sets up a great position for the Steelers for the draft, not having to grab one position or another in a certain round, and they really can go for that best player available that we hear that frequently, but I think that they're staying true to that. We want to get the best player available, period. And yep. not have our hand.
All right. Before we close this one down, I just want to remind everybody about the Steel City Underground contest that we're running. You can win an autographed Troy Polamalu jersey. And all you got to do essentially is go to Steel City Underground, check out the Emily's Story page, or check out the contest page. There are links there that take you over to a website for the March of Dimes. If you make a donation there and you put in the comments Steel City Underground, for every dollar that you donate, you get an entry into the contest. And on April 29th, which is the day of the March of Dimes walk, I'm going to jump on Periscope, do a random drawing, and whoever wins gets that jersey. It'll get sent to you. Last year, we gave away a full-size Rocky Blyer autographed helmet to a guy. This year, we're giving away the jersey, Troy Polamalu autographed jersey. So, you know, it's a great cause. Do us a favor. Jump over. Make a donation. Help support the kids and keeping babies and mothers healthy. And maybe you will be the proud owner of a Troy Polamalu jersey signed by Troy. So, in the meantime, that's going to kick off or end, I should say, our trilogy of Bell stories. You know,
yes, the revenge of the franchise the tag revenge of the is now ended.
Yeah, revenge of the franchise tag. So, Tina, I want to thank you for coming aboard. You, as always, providing excellent insight carrying my old butt along.
Well, and I think Joe will be happy because we didn't diss him this time.
Well, you know, he's been sick. We can't really trash him when he's sick. That's just me.
Well, yeah, that would be low.
Yeah.
Even for our standards.
But, you know, look, what am I going to say? He's a toast lover.
That's it. That's all there is to say about him.
So, Joe, you know, go eat some toast and feel better, man. And, you know, we will hook up in the future. For everybody else, that's going to end it for us today. As always, it's chaos out there. Be kind.
We would like to thank you for listening and remind our listeners to follow us on social media and our website, www.steelcityunderground.com.